good morning and I hope you all are fine. So that you all know that due to this pandemic situation, again we closed the schools and we closed our school. It doesn't mean that you are not having the examination. You are having the examination so that you have to study well. And your revision classes, whatever we have to conduct, that will be going on in your online classes. So go through this thoroughly, and whatever the doubts are there regarding any chapters and all, so that you can clarify with all these revision videos. And here I am going to give you or I am going to discuss you about some of the important questions and all, and I will write all the answers also, and you can copy this and you can prepare for your exams. So let me start the revision class. So here first I am going to discuss about, is matter around us pure? So in that chapter you already know that you have learned many things in that, so that the types of solutions, so whether the matter around us is pure or not, as well as the methods of separation. So impurity means we have to separate it, so that how to separate by using the different methods and all, already you have learned about this. And now I am going to revise some of the important questions regarding this chapter, so let us concentrate on this. So the first question is, what is meant by a pure substance? So pure substance means what? So you know that according to us, what we say, the pure means whatever we consume, so that or whatever we use, we thought that will be the pure. Yes, but according to the scientists, what happened? The pure substance is not actually what. For example, if we say that milk, so for example, if we take the milk, so what we say that the milk is pure, but according to the scientist, yes, the milk is not pure because it is having many constituent particles. So milk means what it contains, every useful components only there. For example, the fats are there, proteins are there, calcium is there, so that they are all essential for our body. So when we take that milk, we said the milk is pure substance. But what about according to the scientist, the calcium is different, the fats are different, and the proteins are different. So it is the mixture of all these things, then it is not pure. So according to the scientist, what is pure substance then? So the answer is given here. A pure substance is the one that consists of a single type of particles. So whatever the particles will be there in the substance, in the pure substance, they are the single type of the particles. That is, all constituent particles of the substance have the same chemical nature, so that whatever the chemical, the constituent particles are there, they should have the same chemical nature. Then if the constituent particles or the whatever the elements, if they are having the same chemical properties, then we can say it as the pure substance. So pure substances, again they can be classified into elements or compounds. So compounds are made with the identical particles, so that we can give the, again we can classify the pure substances as elements or compounds, right? So now again you can see this, a pure substance is the one that consists of a single type of particles, that is all constituent particles of the substance have the same chemical nature. So pure substances can be classified into elements or compounds. So you just write it down and later I will explain the next question. Yes, have you took this? Right. Next we can discuss about the second question. Let me write that. So see, the next question we are having on the board, that is, differentiate between homogeneous and heterogeneous mixtures with examples. So here what you have to do, we know that the homogeneous as well as the heterogeneous mixtures, so we have to differentiate. So when we differentiate, we have to make the column. So the first one is homogeneous mixture and the second one is heterogeneous mixtures. So homogeneous mixtures means, here I have written the differences between the homogeneous as well as the heterogeneous mixtures. A homogeneous mixture is a mixture having a uniform composition throughout the mixture. So uniform composition means here the constituent particles are uniformly spread. Uniformly means we cannot differentiate the different, we cannot able to observe the different particles in the solution or in a mixture. So they are uniformly, whenever in whatever the solution it may be, they are spread throughout uniformly. For example, here is there the salt in water. So if we take a glass of water and if you mix a 1 tablespoon of salt in that, so it, when we dissolve it in the water, so it will form the salting water, or we can also call it as the salt solution. So if we taste that salt solution, so throughout wherever we can take, whatever the portion we can take, either in the top portion or in the middle or at the bottom, so wherever we can taste it, so it will give the same taste. It means that the salt particles are uniformly spread in the water. So such composition of particles, that solution, we can call it as the homogeneous mixture, right? So here a homogeneous mixture is a mixture having a uniform composition throughout the mixture, and example for that are salt in water, sugar in water and copper sulfate in water. So there are some of the example for the homogeneous mixture. And the second one is the heterogeneous mixture. So here a heterogeneous mixture is a mixture having a non-uniform composition. So the see the term non-uniform, right? So here in the homogeneous they spread uniformly, and here the mixture having a non-uniform composition throughout the mixture. So if throughout the mixture if there is the non-uniform composition, so if there is the variation in the composition, somewhere it is more, somewhere it is less, so likewise throughout the mixture it will not be uniform, and such mixtures we can call as the heterogeneous mixtures. And example here I have given NaCl. NaCl means it is the common salt, that is sodium chloride, what we are using in our houses. So that the NaCl and iron fillings. So see, if we mix the sodium chloride and iron fillings, you know that iron fillings are they are the very small pieces of iron metal. If we mix the sodium chloride and iron fillings, are they mixed uniformly throughout the mixture? No. So they will be sometimes, what happens, sometimes we can see the more proportion of sodium chloride, or in some parts we can see the more portion of iron fillings, or else sometimes we can see in some corners that will be the quantity will be varies. So they will not spread uniform throughout. That is what we can use the term non-uniform composition. So such mixtures we can call as the heterogeneous mixtures. So one more example for that is salt and sulfur. Yes, salt is this only, the sodium chloride or any other salts we can take, and the sulfur. Sulfur is in the form of powder, so that they will be spread non-uniformly. And the third example is oil and water. Yes, the oil and water, are they mixes each other? No, they will not mix each other, and that is because of their variation in the density. So always we find the layer of oil on the water, because the water is having more density, so that will be in the bottom, and the oil having the lesser density than the water, it will be float on the water, so that they will be not mixed and they form the heterogeneous mixture. Is it clear? Right. So these are the differences between the homogeneous as well as heterogeneous mixtures, and you just make a note on this, or you can take the screenshot and then write. Okay, so now we can discuss the next question. So you are having the third question here, that is how are soap, solution and suspension differ from each other. So now we have to differentiate between the soap, solution and suspension. And already you know that what is the soap, what are solution, as well as what are suspensions. So now we can differentiate among all these three. So the first one is soap. So as I have made the column. So make the column like this and write the points. So soap is a heterogeneous mixture. So heterogeneous mixture means what are the composition of the particles? Yes, they are non-uniformly spread throughout the mixture. So the soap is the heterogeneous mixture. And if we come to the solution, solution is a homogeneous mixture. It means the constituent particles are uniformly spread throughout the mixture. So that is what the solution. And what do you mean by the suspension? So the suspensions are the heterogeneous mixtures. Yes, there also the constituent particles are non-uniformly spread throughout the mixture. They are what we can call as the suspension. And second one, the second difference is solute particles are so small they cannot be seen with the naked eye. So that here the solute particles, solute means what? The constituent particle which is in the less quantity or which can be dissolved in the water or any given solvent. So that component we can call as the solute. So the solute particles in the soil, they are so small, they will be small, they cannot be seen with the naked eye. So simply if we see, we are not able to see the constituent or the solute particles. And here in the solution, the solute particles dissolve and spread uniformly throughout the mixture. So when we dissolve the solute in the solvent, so they will be dissolved completely and they form the uniform mixture or they spread uniformly throughout the mixture. And here the solute particles in suspensions are visible to the naked eye. So they are small, they are bigger particles. The solute particles which are there in the suspension, they are bigger in size and they can be seen to the naked eye. So simply if we see the solution or if we see the mixture, we can differentiate between the solute as well as the solvent particles. Means whatever the smaller and bigger particles, we can differentiate. So here the third difference is the Tinder effect is observed in this mixture. So what do you mean by the Tinder effect? Do you know? Yes, already you have learned about this. So Tinder effect is nothing but it is the scattering of light through the solution or we can say the mixture. So when we make to fall a beam of light in the solution, so it will be scattered and we can able to see the constituent particles in that solution or in the mixture. So that effect we can call as the Tyndall effect. And here in the soil, since it is having the heterogeneous mixture or since the soil is the heterogeneous mixture, we can observe the scattering of light through the soil. So that when we make to fall a beam of light through the soil, we can see the scattering of light. And here in the solution, the Tyndall effect is not observed in this mixture. So here, because in this solution, since the constituent particles are uniformly spread, because it is the homogeneous mixture, so the constituent particles are uniformly spread, so that the light here, we are not able to see the dissolved particles in the solution. So that the Tyndall effect we are not able to observe here. And if we see the suspension, so see here the suspension also the heterogeneous mixture. So can we see the Tyndall effect here? Yes, we can observe the Tyndall effect in the suspensions. And example for the soil are milk of magnesia. And example for solution are the salt in water and the suspension. The example for suspension are chalk powder and water. So these are the differentiations among the soil, solution as well as the suspensions. So we just make a note or take a screenshot of this and later we can write it down. And then we can move towards the next question. So here we are having the next question, that is the numerical problem is there. So here what is the question given? To make a saturated solution, 36 gram of sodium chloride is dissolved in 100 gram of water at 293 Kelvin. So it means it is the temperature. It is given that is 293 Kelvin. So find the concentration at this temperature. So what we have to find? The concentration of the solution. So here they are given data. Whatever they are given in this question. So just see, 36 gram of sodium chloride is dissolved in 100 gram of water. It means that sodium chloride is the solute and water is the solvent. And they had given the mass of the solute as well as the solvent. So mass of sodium chloride is 36 gram and mass of water is 100 gram. So when they are given the masses of both, we can find the concentration by mass percentage. So now with these given data, we can solve and we can find the concentration of this solution. So see the solution, the first one, what they are given here is mass of solute, that is, what is the solute here? Yes, it is sodium chloride, and mass of solute is 36 gram and mass of solvent, that is water. So the mass of water is 100 gram. And if we calculate the mass of the solution, so solution is the mixture of solute as well as the solvent. So when we take the solution is a mixture of solute and solvent. So here, what is the mass of the solute? Yes, it is 36 gram. And the mass of the solvent is 100 gram. If we add these two, the 36 and 100 gram, we will get the mass of the solution. So now I will add this. So mass of solute is 36 gram plus mass of the solvent is 100 gram. So what will be the answer? Yes, it is 136 gram. This is the mass of the solution. And then, therefore, concentration. So since the masses of both solute and solvent are given, so we have to calculate the concentration by mass percentage. So here, the concentration of the solution, we are having the formula for that to calculate the concentration of the solution. So here, since it is mass by mass, we are having this formula here, that is mass of solute divided by mass of solution into 100. So by applying this formula, we can calculate the concentration of the solution. So now see, what is the mass of the solute? Yes, it is 36 and divided by, what is the mass of the solution? Yes, it is 136. So into how much it is there? 100. And if we calculate this, just calculate it, and your answer will be 26.4. So this 26.4 is the concentration of the solution, right? So this is how we have to calculate the concentration of any solution by using this equation, the formula when it is given mass of the both solvent as well as the solute, right? So just write it down in your notebook or take a screenshot, and later you can write, and later we can discuss the next question. So here one more question we are having on the separation techniques, and you have already learned many separation techniques. So how to separate the miscible as well as the immiscible liquids. And here a question is there on the separation of two miscible liquids. So what do you mean by the miscible liquids? First we have to know about that. So already you have learned. So what do you mean by the miscible liquids? So if the two liquids can be mixes each other. So if the mixtures or sorry, if the liquids can be mixed each other, then we can call them as the miscible liquids. So likewise, two miscible liquids are given here. They are the kerosene and petrol. The question is, How will you separate a mixture containing kerosene and petrol so the differentiation in their boiling points is more than 25 degrees Celsius? So which are miscible? Both the kerosene as well as petrol are miscible liquids. So how can we, if their boiling point is differ by more than 25 degrees Celsius, how can we separate these two? So if the miscible liquids are there, then we can use the distillation method. So this is the distillation apparatus, whatever the arrangement I have shown on the board, this is the distillation process. So here what they said, they are given the mixture. So first I will explain about the apparatus. So this is the stand, and here the distillation flask is there, and in that distillation flask we have to take the mixture of kerosene and petrol, the given solution, and to this we have to attach a thermometer. So you know the thermometer is the device which is used to measure the temperature. So measuring the temperature is very important here, because they will be separate depending on their boiling points. So boiling point means which is having the less boiling point, that will be evaporate first, and which is having high boiling point, that will be remain in the flask. So if we compare the kerosene and petrol, the kerosene is having the less boiling point than that of the petrol, so that the kerosene will be evaporates first. And here we have a condenser, this we can call as the water condenser, and it is having the water outlet and cold water in. The two openings will be there, one is to pass the cold water and another one is to pass the hot water. And that how it will be used later I will explain. And this is the water condenser, and here we have taken the beaker, so to separate the any of the liquid which is having the less boiling point. So here how it works. So firstly we have to take the mixture of the kerosene and petrol in the distillation flask, and here it is the Bunsen burner, and so with the help of this Bunsen burner we have to heat the mixture of kerosene as well as the petrol, and simultaneously when we are heating this, we have to observe the temperature in the thermometer. So when it reaches the boiling point of the kerosene starts evaporate. So when it evaporates, it will be in the form of gas, and this will be here, the opening will be there here, and from this the vapors of the kerosene are entered to the water condenser. So when it is in the form of vapor, we know that the condensation process takes place when they touch the cold surface. So here from one open of the water condenser we are passing the cold water, so that this will be the cold surface, and when it enters here, so if when the vapors of the kerosene touches this surface, that will start condensing. It means the vapor are converted into the liquid, so that the kerosene again it will be in the form of liquid, and that will be fall or collected in the beaker. And when the cold water is here, the same temperature will be released by the kerosene, and due to that the water will get hot somewhat, so that will be removed from this water outlet. So likewise continuously the process will be going on till all the kerosene gets vaporized, so that again it will be converted in the water condenser, it will be converted into liquid form, and that will be collected in the other beaker. So likewise we can separate the two miscible liquids, right? So expression you can write with the whatever I have explained, the same expression you can write in your notebook and draw this arrangement in your notebook. Okay, so now we can draw this and we will discuss the next question. So the next question is, name the techniques to separate. So the first one, butter from curd. So to separate the butter from the curd, which technique we are using? Yes, that is centrifugation. The method we The method is evaporation. By the method of evaporation, we can separate the salt from sea water. Then identify this one, camphor from salt. So both are solids here. So we can separate this by the method of sublimation. Yes, these are the separation techniques which we use to separate the water from curd. It is centrifugation. Salt from sea water, it is evaporation, and camphor from salt is sublimation. And the next question, one more question is there here. What type of mixtures is separated by the technique of crystallization? So by the technique of crystallization, what kind of mixtures we can separate? So see, the answer is given here. By the technique of crystallization, pure solids. So some of the crystals, some solids we can say, for example, the salts and all, when we get from the source, like from the sea, we get the salt. But initially, what the salt we get from the sea, that is not pure. So it is having many impurities in them. So other, some of the other minerals or other impurities may be present in that. So whatever the things we needed, that pure solid of that salt we have to obtain, and that technique we can call as the crystallization. So by the technique of crystallization, pure solids are separated from impurities. For example, the first one, salt is obtained from sea, is separated from impurities. And second one is the crystals of alum are separated from impure samples. So these are the what we can separate from the technique of crystallization, right? So we just make a note of this, and we can move towards the last question, and it is having some of the separation, means some other techniques of separation. So here we are having some of the changes, so that we have to identify whether these are the physical or chemical changes. So here some of the changes are given. So already you know, you have learned that what are chemical as well as the physical changes. So first let me recall that what are physical as well as the chemical changes. So if we say that if any change, if it is chemical, then there should be the change in the chemical properties, or any new substance will be formed when the change takes place. If in a change there is a formation of new substance which is entirely different than that of the whatever the things we are used or the initial things. So if the new product is formed and which cannot be reversible again, it means we can say it is irreversible. So such kind of changes we can call as the chemical changes. And if there is any, there is just change in the in their physical properties. Okay, if only in the physical properties if they are changed, there may be the change in the state of matter. So likewise, if any changes are take place physical in the physical properties, and that can be reversible, it means we can retain the things to its original form. So such kind of changes we can call as the physical changes. And here some of the changes are given, and you have to identify whether it is the physical or chemical change. Can you able to identify? Yes. What is this change? Cutting of trees. If we cut the trees, any new product will form there? No. So the physical properties will retain as it is. So before, when it is tree, then also it is having the wood, and after cutting also it is having the wood. So there is no change in the properties. Chemically there is no change of anything. So this cutting of tree is physical change. And the second one, see, melting of butter in pan. So see the word melting. So when we melt something, so it will be in the solid form. So when we freeze it again, we can convert it into solid form. So melting means when the solid substance is converted into liquid, that we can call as the melting. So when it convert into liquid form. Again, if we freeze it or if we kept in the fridge, so that again it will convert it into solid. So this melting of butter in pan is also a physical change. And then boiling of water to form steam. So steam means it is nothing but the water vapors. So if we convert the water into water vapors, it means the if we boil the water, it will convert into steam. And again by we can the steam can be converted into again the water by the condensation. So that this is also the physical change. And passing of electric current through water and the water breaking down into hydrogen and oxygen gases. So the water it is having the molecular formula H2O. Yes. And when we pass the electricity through the water, it will break down into two new substances, that is hydrogen and oxygen gases. So these are the new products. And if in any change the new product has formed and if its chemical properties gets changed, then we can call like that changes as the chemical changes. And see, water is having the different properties and hydrogen and oxygen, they are having the different properties. So see, hydrogen is highly explosive gas, it can catch fire very easily, and oxygen, it supports burning. Yes. So whenever the burning or combustion process takes place, that will be in the presence of oxygen only. But the water, it is exactly opposite to that. So water, we can use it to extinguish the fire, right? So likewise, the properties are entirely changed. So through the electricity, the breaking down of water into hydrogen and oxygen is the chemical change. Okay. Then next one, dissolving common salt in water. Yes, if we dissolve the common salt in water, again by the evaporation we can get the salt back. So it is physical change. And then making of fruit salad with the raw fruits. So raw fruits, by taking the raw fruits, we will chop it and we will prepare the fruit salad. So when we chop it or when we cut the fruits, their physical properties or their chemical properties will not change. So fruit will be, even if we cut also, the fruit will be remain as fruit only. So that it is physical change. And the last one, it is burning of paper and wood. See, so when we cut the trees, that is physical change. When we cut, there is no change in the chemical properties and no new substance is formed here. But when we burn the paper and wood, it will be changed. The chemical properties will get changed and wood will be converted, the wood as well as the paper will be converted into ash. So the new substance has formed. So that this burning of not only the paper and wood, burning of anything is the chemical change. So that this is chemical change. Right. So are you understood this? Just take it down, take screenshot or and make a note later. Okay, well, so that for today's class this much only, and I will conclude my this session here. So in the next class we can discuss the next chapter. I hope you have got some idea how to read and all, so that you can take the help of this and study well at your home. Don't waste your time. Thank you. Have a nice day.